They come together. And already it's brutal. But Sapp is down on his back. And this is one of the conceivable ways that it could end, because Gracie is an excellent submission fighter. This fight is brought to you by Jaco. And it may not be a long one, Jason.
No, Hollis did exactly what Hollis needed to do. Get the fight to the ground as quickly and efficiently as possible. I'm actually kind of surprised that Bob Sapp was able to work a little bit of guard and survive an ankle lock attempt. So this could be a little longer fight than we anticipate.
Well, he's tried his hand at a number of different fighting styles, Bob Sapp. This is his latest modus operandi. Used to be an American footballer with the Minnesota Vikings.
Bob Sapp has done everything. He's a movie star, he's a product endorser, you know, former K-1 kickboxer and MMA fighter. Bob takes a lot of flack. People think that, you know, he's not really an MMA fighter, and he wants to prove that this is Bob Sapp 2.0.
Oh, there's a big punch that Gracie just landed. He tried for a second. The first one really got through, and the last couple have as well. And Bob Sapp could be in trouble, and it is over. They were heavy punches. I could see them very clearly here. Bob Sapp was on his back, and he took two or three heavy, heavy blows from Oles Gracie. Bob Sapp's up, and he's that's the way it is in MMA. Great sportsmanship from Bob Sapp, but he took some big, big blows to the head. And make no mistake, Oles Gracie is a huge man in his own right, and he's got great athleticism. He really let Bob Sapp have it there on the ground. And you know, when the blows are coming in as heavy as those were, they cannot last for long. You can't let a fight like that go on for much longer, because it's serious stuff, it's dangerous stuff. And great respect to our referee for jumping in time. Let's take another look. It went to the mat quickly, as we expected it would. But then our expectations were that Gracie would get a submission. But it's these blows that you're seeing with the right hand that did the damage. And you could see the pain on Bob's face there. He took one at the top of the head, on the back of the head, which is often dangerous. And can dull your senses. We said it would be quick, folks. And it certainly was. Some speculation as to whether Bob Sapp actually tapped out there and called the fight before the referee got a chance. Let's hear the official word in a few moments.
Ladies and gentlemen, the winner by way of tap out due to strikes after 1 minute, 18 seconds of round one, from the blue corner, Hollis Gracie.
And these punches should be extremely meaningful. First of all, though, a kick from Alain in the black trunks, Hassan in the pale blue. And if there is a violent takedown in this one, the whole stadium could rock. Oh my word! A spinning kick that knocked Hassan straight down, and in comes the referee. Kenichi Serizawa didn't want to see any more of that, and I do not blame him. And look at Alain marching around the cage as if he owns it. This one was over so quickly that Jason Chambers didn't even get a word in.
Yeah, you're absolutely correct, Steve. Just making some notes, and I looked up there and caught that spinning back kick. That was just incredible. And that shows you the pedigree of a very high-level striker. It's so tremendously difficult to keep your balance and have the whereabouts about landing those kicks, especially when you're 245 pounds of pure muscle.
Look at those biceps.
Sure, we're going to be able to see that kick again here in a second. That was just absolutely on the money, and it rocked Hassan a little bit and put him off balance. You see here, Hassan set up a couple of punches, and then Alain just grazed him right on the temple with that toe.
seemed to get him around the temple, didn't it? Perhaps
let's
just
take a look
on
at
the top of
the
nose.
Side.
So rare that these are executed well enough, but yeah, high on the head, that one.
Perfect foot to the temple, and there's a few buttons, and that just put Hassan enough on crazy street to get a little rocked.
A disorienting shot. It seems to have landed high, but they're tending to Hassan's nose, to his nose as he sits on the stool.
Ladies and gentlemen, referee Kenichi Serizawa calls a halt to this bout at 31 seconds of the very first round for your winner via referee stoppage due to strikes from the red corner, the Black Panther, Alain Ngalani.
I have a hard time believing this one's going to go the distance.
Don't get up and make your cup of tea just yet. England against Australia, a long history and tradition.
It just swings for the fences.
Rivalry.
Oh, that right hand shaved.
Wow, it was a close one, that one.
Octave just swings with everything behind those punches, trying to knock you out with a jab. It's a dangerous exchange to get in the middle there when you're packing 120 kilos. That's 120 kg of power behind those punches, too. Your chin doesn't grow in size no matter how big you get.
Oh, heavy legs McSweeney has. You pointed it out. Those kicks he likes to employ, and they're damaging.
You notice that McSweeney, his hands are really low, and when he's breaking away from these exchanges, he's coming back with his head up, and even though Loctiff is missing his chin, I'm a little worried that he might get one landed right on the button. See the difference in how their hands are being held. Loctiff's hands are up higher. McSweeney's kind of got those hands by the hips, but man, he's launching kicks at rapid-fire pace.
Big man, he really does unleash them quickly, doesn't he? But he takes a couple of good punches there.
Got to get his hands up and chins down. Chin down.
Loctiff with some great accuracy with the hands. It's give and take in this one.
Oh, nice leg kick. Someone should tell these guys they're not bantamweights. They shouldn't be throwing this many kicks. It's crazy.
And not at this speed either. Oh, that was heavy. Oh, that's it. It's not going to go any further than that. What a way to finish, my goodness me.
That was bananas. Someone called the Chiquita Man because holy cow. Crazy flying knee. I think we've got to see that again. That was just perfectly timed. You know, Chris Loctiff doesn't really look like he knows what happened. Well, it was just precision surgery.
We did not need a referee to stop that one, did we? We knew it was over as soon as that knee made contact.
And he got clipped on the chin a couple times, moving backwards, and almost ate a kick to the face. But you see right here, body kick, and he hurt him with that body kick.
Oh!
Right behind the ear with
and
that
he
knee.
Ducked into it just at the wrong moment as well. Wow, what a finish. And he just walked away. Cool as you like. Heavy, heavy knees. On his 1FC debut, improves his mixed martial arts record to 19-10. 33-year-old James McSweeney. Here's Anthony Suntar.
Ladies and gentlemen, referee Olivier Cost calls a halt to this battle with 3 minutes, 4 seconds remaining in round number one. For your winner, via knockout from the blue corner, James Sledgehammer McSweeney.
This fight brought to you by Star Sports. Hassan in the yellow, Cheng in the white and black, and already they're unloading. And Cheng gets caught with two vicious left hands, and he's taking the brunt of the punishment here. Although both men were throwing punches heavily.
Well, you know, like we talked about, we thought Hassan was going to come out aggressive, and Cheng, Hassan both just stood in the pocket and played rock'em sock'em robots. The only problem with that is somebody's chin is going to get tested. You know, you have to really be able to slip, dodge, and weave and know when you're throwing those punches that your opponent's going to throw back.
Cheng is cut. There's blood on his forehead. Not quite sure where the cut's coming from, but he's bleeding all over Hassan's shorts.
See if we can get a look at that.
Hassan's in on a front choke here. It doesn't look like it's that deep because Cheng is up on his feet and he's got the pressure where it needs to be. That choke is pretty tight, but you know Cheng's gonna rally out of this here, it looks like.
So the cut is over the right eye, and that's a dangerous place for it to be, and he's coming back with punches to the body.
It is dangerous because when you have those cuts over the eye, they can bleed into your eye. You know, even though if Cheng can just hang on here and just kind of take some of that pressure off with his hand like he's doing there and fight the hand grip, Mahmoud is using a lot of energy and a lot of strength, squeezing on that choke. The lactic acid builds up.
Especially for a big man, it's going to tire him out. We're not expecting Hassan to be as potent on the ground as perhaps Cheng will be. Cheng is slightly more rounded.
Well, you know, like I said, that choke, it looks like it's affecting Cheng. I can't really tell if this is one of those I might tap scenarios, but he knows that if he can just hang on, he can just pry these hands loose here.
He's trying.
You hear the crowd getting behind him. There he is. He's out.
Listen to the crowd.
Payback time from the top.
Here we go. Swings and roundabouts.
This is where Hassan has to be careful because he's reaching up nice and high, and Cheng is versed in submissions. He's going to start to look to attack that lead arm.
Olivier Coste warns Cheng not to punch on the back of the head. A gum shield's come out.
That's usually indicative of your opponent getting tired because the gum shield, as you call it, sir, it restricts your breathing.
Mouthpiece is what you like to call it, right?
I like to call it the teeth saver. Hassan here is getting really tired. You can tell he spit out that mouthpiece. I think he may have really used up a lot of his energy with that initial choke.
Cheng pressing down with that elbow. He's used it as quite a potent weapon there about 30 seconds ago. Looking also for knees to the head and body. There's another left knee to the head. Cheng, who was in quite a bit of trouble in the early moments of this opening round, is coming back. What an intriguing contest this is.
And he has a lot of time to work too. 2 minutes left, and you know he has to be careful here if you're Hassan, because you are in a really bad spot. And you see Hassan's holding onto the head of Cheng, trying to hold him down, but he's really exposing that arm. Cheng can step around for a far side armbar. He can start working Kimuras. Or he can just work that right knee across the belly of Hassan and move into mount. Little bit late here, but there's that wrestling base that we're talking about. See those hips just digging in deep. It's going to be very hard for Hassan to get Cheng off here.
Again, the elbow, the forearm onto Hassan's head.
Nice punches.
And the back.
One-way ticket to Backville. This could be the beginning of the end here. Hassan has a minute to survive in this position. That's 260 pounds of beef coming down out of the sky, too. That's really going to take its toll.
And when those punches come under the armpit, as they are doing there, they're landing flush on the face. Hassan taking a lot of punishment. Olivier Coste asking him to defend himself and do so effectively, because if he doesn't, Olivier Coste will step in here.
Well, he's got 40 seconds to hang on. One of the things Olivier Coste is going to look at is that Hassan turned his back, and that's a defensive maneuver. It's a little like you're kind of giving up that position because you're taking punishment.
And we must have had 30-plus blows rained down. Taking punishment is what you said. He's not giving anything back, the Egyptian.
Yeah, we haven't really seen anything in the way of offense from Hassan on the ground. He had that guillotine choke in a little bit. But it's going to be a whole other round here in about 10 seconds. And we're really going to get to see whose cardio is going to play a factor here. Because big guys, it's one of the things that the trade-off of that strength is the lactic acid buildup and all the oxygen that your muscles use.
He survived. There must have been, Jason, 50 or so unanswered punches from Paul Cheng. And it's no wonder that Mahmoud Hassan is struggling to get up. He still hasn't got up. There he is. Well, he can consider himself quite a fortunate man.
That was so much action in this round, too. And, you know, like we talked about, both guys just sitting there on their heels and just throwing punches. And that's just a trade-off. I'm going to go for you. You're going to go for me. And then you saw that Cheng went in on that takedown and landed in top position. Spent most of that first minute and a half defending the guillotine, but then once he was free, he was just all over Hassan.
Wow, look at that eye. Not only cut, but it is entirely closed. Paul Cheng will fight the rest of this contest looking through his left eye only.
That really affects you too, because your depth perception is completely thrown off with one eye. But what a warrior spirit Paul Cheng is, you know, having his hometown fans here to back him up and rile him up. He has no quit in him, that's for sure. That is nasty looking.
Mahmoud Hassan will look across the cage and he'll see that closed eye. And despite the beating he took in the final minute and a half of that first round, he's bound to take some consolation from that injury. Remember that damage caused is a factor when scoring in ONE FC. We judge fights in their entirety, not round by round. And what a thriller of a first round that was. Now, Cheng, as a southpaw, has that open eye, the left eye, to see with.
You know, I gotta think that I'm surprised Hassan is being as patient as he was. Rich Franklin here, how do you see this for damage so far?
Well, you could almost score Cheng for a near KO at the end there with the punches. I'm not sure how effective that was, but I'm looking at him ahead on the scorecards right now for damage inflicted in that round.
Oh, Cheng's down, and he takes, oh, and he was gonna take a knee to the head, but incredible reversal from Paul Cheng. That was monumental. And Mahmoud Hassan has been cut over his left eye. These two are giving and taking quite a lot of punishment directly above us here at cage side at the NTU Sports Center.
It's almost disconcerting making eye contact with Cheng here as he's in on a double leg. I mean, the tenacity, you know, he ate a couple of big shots. He's given a couple of big ones right back here. And oh, just missed with that left.
Hassan's face is a mess. We talked about the damage done to Paul Cheng, but Hassan now is perhaps the man. If we can just get a look at how serious that is, certainly the doctor's going to take a look at it.
Well, fighter safety obviously is always the most important thing here, and bumps and bruises usually don't stop fights, but my goodness, hematomas can.
He's got a little lump on the right side of his forehead, but it's over the left eye where the problem is. Clearly it was bad enough for Olivier Coste to ask the doctor's advice. Meanwhile, Paul Cheng also is bleeding from the nose, as well as having that right eye completely closed. He gets a wipe down from Olivier Coste. Look at these two warriors. Here we go, second round is resumed with 3:45 to go.
And both men just very cognizant of this other's striking prowess, and more importantly, with the power packed behind those punches. I think Cheng wisely goes in here for a double leg takedown and try to exploit that grappling prowess.
Oh, the knee to the head from Hassan. And that was on the good eye.
You know, you'll see guys that don't fight the takedown like Hassan there, looking for that guillotine, and it's kind of a risky factor because you have to be really sure that you're gonna be able to grab that neck and really connect with that. And that's fine if you don't want to fight a takedown, if you think you can get the submission, but if you just get in a position here and you can see on Hassan's face, he is really muscling this guillotine.
And you can see why his mouthpiece fell out, because he sort of plays with it as he's exerting all that effort in the guillotine.
He's trying to breathe and get more oxygen. I mean, he's using a tremendous amount of strength here. And one of the things I don't think he's cognizant of is that he has Paul Cheng's right arm trapped in there. So even though there's a lot of pressure on Paul's neck, he's expending more muscle and more oxygen in just the lactic acid buildup by squeezing constantly. And as the fight goes on, that's gonna play a huge factor in your punching ability and your defensive ability. So Paul's just kind of playing possum a little bit here.
He slipped out of it. The blood and the perspiration will have helped. Now, forearm on the face, we've seen that before.
And Paul Cheng's gonna try to work right into mount here. He's in cross-eyed, past the guard of Hassan. He's gonna start throwing those punches down. again, start working the knees to the face.
What a brutal contest this is.
Yeah, Hassan has to get those arms back too. He's reaching far too high. Paul Cheng's gonna realize that. All right, in the mount now. Paul Cheng's gonna realize that Hassan's arms are up so high, he's gonna start attacking those.
But look how weary Cheng is. There's nothing in those punches. It's just all arm.
Yeah, both guys look like they're running on fumes here. I mean, that's one of the things that heavyweights, everyone loves them because they have those powerful punches and huge knockouts, but there's a trade-off in the cardiovascular aspect.
You are allowed to kick off the fence like that, just not allowed to grip it with your toes or your fingers.
I gotta think that Cheng's gonna look for a submission here at some point because he's mounted just raining down monkey punches.
Probably better off going off with the elbows and the forearms, I think, rather than these lumbering punches that are really not doing any damage.
Yeah, I mean, Hassan is giving him an arm. He is just putting that hand right in his face. He's extended all the way. If Cheng just secures that arm and starts giving him something to think about, he's gonna have a lot of opportunities for submissions here. Just completely gassed, too. Yeah. Oh, here, he's setting up that armbar like we just talked about. Watch for Cheng to secure the right arm of Hassan, and he's going to swing that left leg over. Hassan's going to have about a half a second to shoot that arm back. Cheng's waiting for the end of the round here. You can tell he doesn't have much cardio or gas left in the tank. He doesn't want to risk too much. But he knows he wants to look for that armbar. That's why that S-mount is... He changed his mind.
He's just exhausted, isn't he? 24 seconds left. And these two are totally spent. Oh, goodness me. Such big men to go at that early pace for so long.
Yeah, that was... I'm surprised he didn't go for the armbar there. I think if he would have went for it, maybe he just felt, you know, if I miss it, I don't have the gas to fight off my back right now. It might have been a strategic ploy, but that S-mount you saw there where he was working his leg up was definitely looking to work for submissions.
Well... Paul Cheng's right eye is far bigger even than it was 5 minutes. And look at the way he's walking back. It was a great effort for him to even get on his stool.
Yeah, it was just another great exchange here. Good right hand landed by Hassan, and then a right hand and a left hook landed. And that flying knee missed, but right into a double leg takedown. Five more minutes of heavyweight action coming at us. This fight could go either way. You know, I was surprised. You know, you don't see too many heavyweight matchups that go into deep waters.
I would imagine that Paul Cheng is slightly ahead. But there's some doubt about whether we're going to get a third round.
You want to continue on? No, you want to stop?
It is over. Well, he staggered on his feet as he stood up from the stool. He nearly fell over. If it hadn't been for the cage wall, he would have fallen over. And Olivier Coste has called it a day.
Holy cow.
There's a bit of an argument in the corner there. Yuji Shimada stepped in as well just to support his man. Seems to me that Olivier Coste is saying that all of the body language coming from Mahmoud Hassan was that I don't want to quit, and he's been awarded a yellow card because of his complaints.
That perplexes me. The fight's over. How are you getting a yellow card? You know, that's interesting. I wonder if that was Hassan's corner, or if it was Hassan just saying, I don't have anything left and I don't want to sit there anymore. But either way, I think that's got to be a pleasant surprise for Paul Cheng. You think you got five more minutes.
I think there might have been a bit of dissent from the corner there, not happy with the stoppage. But I think Olivier Coste felt entirely justified. You could visibly see that he would have fallen over if it hadn't been for the cage wall. But as we look at Hassan struggling to stay upright, Paul Cheng is barely able to be upright as well. Let's get the official decision then.
Ladies and gentlemen, referee Olivier Coste calls a halt to this battle right before we began round number three. For your winner, via corner first stoppage, Paul Typhoon Cheng!
Land some leg kicks. After talking a little bit, he's gonna stay on the outside. Throw some leg kicks to the takedowns there, he'll take it. There he goes. Look for Sabora to step in big with some big punches, try and get the knockout. Oh, rocked him already.
Top of the head, and it sent Sabora back to the cage
big,
wall.
Big knees to the clinch.
Three knees to the head. The crowd going absolutely crazy here in Manila. Is this going to be a quick finish?
Brandon's doing work right now. He needs to get back on that head kick again. Maybe set it up with a low and then go back up top.
Sabora is hurt, is grimacing despite that flying punch that he just tried. Boom. Takes a big kick to the midriff. But he's still punching back. Vera still throwing those kicks there to the inside of the thigh.
Brandon's just picking him apart right now. Sabora needs to actually back away.
Sabora grimaces again. He's suffering pain somewhere. Nice short right hand from the Ukrainian. Solid ramrod jab from Vera.
Brandon's got to keep those hands up, though. Igor's still dangerous. It's first round, it's still fresh. Brandon's pawn on the outside a little bit. But then we probably go to the body, the inside of the leg again. You can tell he's getting ready to load throw that kick. Brandon needs to keep those hands up tight, though. Igor's recovered now. He's feeling fresh.
Both men swinging. Both men just ducking under the punches. Heavyweights, it could finish any second. Big man can get that leg up really high. Right hand and a left as well from Sabora.
Sabora's bleeding a little bit from the tip, the bridge of his nose.
Igor's a little bit uncomfortable with something. He's been practicing for a while now, and it could be the nose that's causing him trouble.
A little bit of redness around the left eye as well. Brandon keeps switching stance, keeping Igor thrown off a little bit. Sabora's still dangerous. He's coming in with that big right. This is what he said he was going to do.
Oh, kick to the midriff. And that kick just above the knee that could hyperextend it. Damaging kick, that is. Straight pushes the thigh back, locks the knee up. Good left hand from Igor. Sent Brandon back a pace. Looks for it again. Leaps in with it. Nice high guard from Brandon Vera. Left hand again from the Ukrainian. Oh, right hand, it was a good one.
Brandon stepping in, throwing those short little choppy elbows. Stand on the outside, really executing his game plan to a T right now. I talked to him the other day, he said this was exactly what he wanted to do.
Brandon looking for the left hand downstairs. Gets clipped by a couple. Oh! The fans here are going nuts. In the end, it finished in super quick style. Devastating punch. And in came the ground kicks. Igor Sabora is up on his feet and he looks okay. Brandon Vera goes over to reach for him on the shoulder, shake his hand.
And what he did is he waited for Igor to throw.
Oh. What a straight left hand that was. And that was more than enough for Olivier Cost. Well, we're bound to be in Manila a couple of times or so, at least in 2015. What's the betting? Brandon Vera will be on most cards. And hopefully elsewhere in Asia. He likes a little dance.
Ladies and gentlemen, referee Olivier Cost calls a hold to this battle at 3 minutes, 54 seconds of round number one. for your winner, via knockout, Brandon the Truth Vera!
Shibora coming right at Ngalani. You can see him.
Oh, oh wow. I flinched down here.
You can just see him trying to set up that big left kick. He's like pulling it all the way back from Hong Kong. Oh, wow. That was a nice body shot right there. That
legs
hurt
are so huge that he's getting really hit. In come the punches, and Sabora's in trouble. Those legs are just so strong and powerful.
You gotta be careful once you feel that your opponent weaken a little bit, and he's starting to exert a lot of energy right there. He's gotta be careful, he doesn't gas himself out, but he's going right back to the body again.
Left up to the body, oh, big punches to the face.
Oh,
Untidy with the ground and pound. Can he get the space to work hard? The hammer blows come down. That's 4, 5. The left hand. Sabora trying to block them, but he's having precious little success with it. Sabora is grazed and possibly cut on the head. Olivier Costa is ready to pounce. It's finished. In a minute and 10 seconds, he turns around and salutes the crowd again. Alain Ngalani.
Subora right there, and it was just a moment, and you can just see the punches coming down and his head bouncing back up off the canvas like he was dribbling a basketball. Here you can see that vicious left body kick that hurt Subora.
You saw him grimace, yeah.
And you can see him just fading a little bit, and Ngalani jumps all over him with that big right hand, drops him right there, and then you can just see him dribbling the head off the canvas with big right hands.
Olivier Cost putting his life on the line there. I mean, heavy was the word. Everything about every kick and punch that was thrown was just heavy.
Man, you can just see the welts on the side of Subora's body from that big left body kick with Ngalani. Must be like swinging a tree at you.
I'm glad to say that Subora is up on his feet and will get over to Olivier Cost for Anthony's official decision.
Ladies and gentlemen, referee Olivier Cost calls a halt to this battle at 1:09 of round number one. For your winner, via referee stoppage due to strikes, Alain the Panther Ngalani!
Brandon Vera immediately starts with some of those brutal leg kicks that he's known for.
And lands to the head.
Paul Cheng trying to answer. Paul Cheng's got to make this fight dirty. He cannot stand there in front of Brandon Vera and let him do what he does best.
But that left hook did significant damage. That kick landed flush on the jaw. The follow-up barely needed. We have a heavyweight champion.
And now the one heavyweight world champion, Brandon the Truth Vera!
Could be over very quickly. Oh, wow. You just take cover whenever Ngalani swings that big, big leg of his.
Ngalani is about as wide as I am tall. He looks massive, like a superhero, the Panther.
And he does a lot of cardio. I mean, you can see, I guess, but I saw him on the treadmill for a long, long time yesterday. This was the day before the fight.
You can see that Bezon does not want any part of the stand-up game with Ngalani, but this is a bad spot for him to be in. Bezon has side control, but he's doing the right thing. He's pushing away, creates a little bit of space.
Strength to lift this man up like that.
He basically bench-pressed him into half guard.
Oh, wow. And then got to his feet. That was a tremendous feat of strength. And a big right hand.
Big.
And he's unloading now. Amachado's in big trouble. He has to go for the legs to try and get some respite, but it's not coming because Ngalani kept going with the right hand. A tremendous effort from Machado to bring him down.
Nice single leg trip there. Machado knew he got hurt.
Yuji Shimada making sure that Galani's elbow doesn't make contact with the back of the head. Very important. That's why he stopped the action for a while there.
Yeah, he did exactly the principles behind BJJ. He weathered the big strikes, got this fight back down to the ground where he negates a lot of that power, those strikes that Ngalani has. Let's see if Ngalani can do another one of those bench press escapes again as he tries to get out of there. He does not want to spend too much time on the ground with a black belt, the capability of Machado. He's kind of going the wrong way. Now he's going the right way. Now he's stripping away from the side, but he's got to create more space. But that, all those big muscles, they just suck up so much oxygen. You know, they eat so much energy up. But he believes that he's like, oh, I'm a bodybuilder. That's true. He's a championship level bodybuilder. But he doesn't believe. Now he's got some possible arm triangle by Machado.
He's got tight around the throat, but he swivels around within it. Very nicely done.
Good job by Ngalani to avoid that arm triangle. Now he's giving up the back, though. He doesn't want it to go this way. Machado's got that arm there on the arm. He's trying to release that. He's going to drop some bombs first.
Bench press is coming from this position. This is trouble.
Now he gets flattened out. Uses those hips to kind of spread him out. Now comes some big strikes. Ngalani's got to move. He can't stand there. Yuji Shimada's not going to take it.
Got to be careful of the back of the head.
It's like that mohawk, Steve. It's just that. Imagine if you have a missile mohawk. You can't come anywhere near it.
If you make contact with the ear, it's a legal blow.
You have to intelligently defend yourself. You can't just stay there with your hand protect.
Just cover up. He's taking quite a lot of punishment. He doesn't seem overly bothered by it, but this is a heavyweight, and a big heavyweight who's landing the blows.
He's got to move, Steve. He's got to move. He's got to create a scramble. He can't just sit there. Closing him out. Too bad. Here comes the rain.
Covering up well, though, Ngalani. The hand blows have to go between the arms in order to land. A few in at the side there just to bury it. Ngalani's in trouble here.
He's got to forget about protecting his face and start pushing off on those legs. He can't stay there and just cover it up.
Got to lift those hips and do something about it because he is a sitting duck at the moment with 90 seconds of this first round still to go. The punches come hammering down from the Brazilian.
But they're not making contact. He's completely defending and covering up all these shots.
He is covering up well.
A little bit of the hooks on the side are getting through and landing there. But he's giving him, there it is,
the arm. The armbar attempt, but that's a strong arm. I'm not sure he'll be able to pull that one all the way to full extension.
He's trying to get it out, but I don't think he's in trouble. I think the elbow's past the groin, so he's not. He's just cranking on the wrist there.
That's a big voice. Now the right hand goes to work immediately above us here at cage side.
How much energy are these two expending? You know, Machado thought he probably had the finish. He's letting everything go with those hammer fists.
Big blows.
Ngalani's doing the same thing.
25 seconds left, bitch. It's been an exhausting first 5 minutes for these two.
Back and forth. Bibizon gets back on top. Machado gets a knee to the head.
And now,
I'm surprised it's gone this far. Big takedown attempt.
It's gonna go into a second round. And not many people thought that.
Is this gonna be the fight 88, or Fun 88, fight of the night?
It could well be. That was a blistering first 5 minutes.
Look at this takedown attempt. Once he got the leg, he was able to suck that leg in, secure the takedown, and he just never let go. And he just used it very nicely, was able to get on top, use a lot of the ground and pound. Here's Ngalani's answer to that. He was letting go a lot of strikes, but again, Machado was able to suck that leg in, weather the storm, and get a dominant position. This is where most of the fight took place, but Ngalani wasn't hurt by any of these. There's a submission attempt, but you can see that his arm is in danger. Machado was in control of more of the fight, you know, but Ngalani was back and forth, very close first round.
I want to see the man who can successfully deliver an armbar to Alain Ngalani's right arm, because that would be a strong man.
Man, no. He's got to be exhausted. He can't even get up off his stool. I don't know if he has the juice to get up.
There's a little bit of confusion in Ngalani's corner there. Yuji Shimada asking if he can fight or not. It took a long time for Ngalani to get up off his stool.
He's exhausted.
He will be very tired. He's got a big, big body to pull around the ring.
He's exhausted, and this is much longer than 1 minute. They got to get this fight underway.
Yuji Shimada literally had to push his men out of the cage and ask several times if he wanted to continue. That's the problem with a body the size of his. Carrying it around full intensity for 15 minutes is very, very tough. Ngalani is feeling the heat.
I don't know if he's going to have the juice to stop this takedown. Here he is clearly holding the cage to avoid the takedown.
He's gone. He's exhausted, Ngalani. It's over. You can see that Alain Ngalani didn't really want much of that fight once the second round started. And look at the emotion on the face of Alexander Machado. 34 years old, improving his record to 8-2, and that is how much it means to him.
It was a very important fight for him. He knew that was at stake, and he wants nothing more than to possibly challenge the champion, Brandon Vera, for the heavyweight strap.
What a contest that could be. Brandon Vera, our heavyweight champion, has got them lining up looking to topple him. Well, Alexander Machado has just put himself in pole position for that one. But these big, big guys can't really be expected to put themselves through an intense first 5 minutes like that. Ngalani is still struggling with just the sheer exhaustion from the first 5 minutes. I'm not sure if he's carrying any kind of injury, but he certainly looks distressed from just an energy-sapping point of view. And you talk about the sapping of energy, Machado from a totally different direction is emotionally exhausted, isn't he? What a night for these two.
Ladies and gentlemen, referee Yuji Shimada calls a halt to this battle. 21 seconds of round number two. For your winner, via tap out, Alexandre Machado!
You can see that big height advantage that Vera has immediately.
Yeah, that long reach is gonna be a very difficult obstacle for Hideki Sekine to try to get close to, but he is a judo black belt. He's a Brazilian jiu-jitsu black belt. He's got a wealth of grappling experience, so he's gotta try to get in there and get one of those legs and drag this fight to the ground.
So far, it's Sekine. Whoa! Just takes a battering leg to the head, but he continues to circle the perimeter of the cage as Vera stalks him.
Those legs come with such heat and power.
Now he goes downstairs, the outside of Sekine's right leg.
Brandon Vera just stalking forward, looking for these shots. Sekine was almost there, he got close. I don't think Sekine has thrown a strike yet, but he's absorbed a couple of leg kicks. He can't take too many of those, or it's gonna also limit his ability to shoot in and possibly grab that single leg.
Scheduled for 5 5-minute rounds, nobody here at Cageside seriously thinks it's gonna go 25 minutes.
He told me he wants to punch his way into a clinch and utilize some of those judo takedowns to get this fight to the ground.
Right hand, knee to the head from Vera. Sekine grabs hold and tries to press Vera up against the cage.
That's what he needs to do. He needs to pressure Vera, stay close to him, eliminate that striking ability, and utilize the takedown.
Tries
nice
for the
clinch.
Knee to the head again. Sekine's overhand right missed, and I think he's in a little bit of trouble. Dabs at his right eye, goes for the single leg, misses it badly. Brandon Vera has an opportunity now, but he backs off. Not wanting to get down there. Right hand straight to Sekine's face, and I think his nose is in a bit of trouble, the Japanese fighter. And the crowd chanting Brandon Vera's name so loudly that I can barely hear myself speak.
Brandon Vera must know that he has this a huge advantage on the feet, and he's just waiting to pick his strikes. He's not being overly aggressive. He knows Sakine is dangerous, and he could clinch up tight and drag the fight to the ground. But Vera's very patient,
he's
waiting to
very
pick his
patient.
Shots.
Yeah, he really is being very patient, Vera. He's not going to get too excited and jump into a nest of vipers.
Yeah, his nose definitely looks crooked. I think that shot
definitely didn't look like that when he got in the cage. And that's a huge kick to the head. And that nose will be no better off as a result, I can assure you.
Yeah, his nose is going the wrong way. Oh, a body shot, that hurt him.
And he goes upstairs as well. And it's going to be a matter of time now. The knee to the head was just an obliterating move. Sakine grabbed for all his worth. Brandon Vera jumps on top, sends in repeated left hands.
One heavyweight world champion, Brandon the True Vera!
It's got its own gravitational pull. Looking for a takedown, trying to put his hands. Oh, Ngalani catches it! It's goodnight, Irene! My word! It's over in a matter of seconds! And Sakine is out cold! Open the fridge, he's out cold!
Sakine rushes Ngalani, and you can just see Ngalani waiting. Pinpointing the knockout blow and ends the night of Sakine. Look at this, beautifully timed, measured with the left hand, delivered with the right.
Mitchell was a combination of timing, precision, and Sakine's own forward-coming momentum that dropped himself into that right hand.
He basically just ran right into that giant right hand of Alain Ngalani.
Right into a car battery.
Ladies and gentlemen, your referee Yuji Shimada has put a stop to this contest after 11 seconds in the first round for your winner by way of knockout, Alain Ngalani.
Here we go. From Studio City in Macau, China, one Super Series match under kickboxing's global rule set. Look out for the spinning hook kicks of Alain Ngalani. Look out for those Dutch-style low kicks on Tariq Kebabi.
Not clinching, okay. Go!
You can see, Michael, he's doing exactly what you talked about. Galani's trying to create that space. Kebabez is trying to close it and get nice and tight.
What Galani's got to be careful of is not to drop his hands and leave them down around his waist, because Kebabez does have heavy artillery in the leather.
Go!
Let's see how quickly Galani can get used to the distance. Turning back into the liver of the Moroccan.
Galani's trying to kick, but Kebabez is trying to throw those hands.
Galani gets underneath. Kebabez throws a knee, completely legal under the kickboxing rule set. Kebabez comes forward again. Gut muncher, then went up to the jaw from Galani. Throws the overhand right. Kebabez trying to get in close to negate the spinning kicks of Galani. Look how low Galani's hands are. The big man's got to keep the gloves up. Kebabez throws an uppercut. And Galani drifts off. Goes counterclockwise, staying out of the right hand and right kick range of Kebabez. Body shot from Ngalani. He's quick for a big man, is Alain Ngalani. An inside kick, ducks under the left hook, clinches up.
Not clinching, okay?
No clinching allowed in the kickboxing global rule set here at One Super Series.
It's like he's dropping his head to possibly going for a takedown. And that's where he's ended up in that clinch that the referee's warned about.
How
big
about that? The Andy Hook style X kick from Ngalani. Ngalani does have a background in Kyokushin Karate. The axe kick is a trademark of the Kyokushin Karateka. The likes of Andy Hook, Claube Feitosa, Francisco Filio, and we saw it there from Alain Ngalani. Mawashigeti roundhouse kick off the lead leg from Ngalani. Good jab too from the Cameroonian. Got to get out of the corner. Here come the heavy hands from the Moroccan Kebabes. Throws the knee. Kebabes unloading. Doesn't want to let Ngalani out of the corner here.
Go, go.
Ngalani, jab two, kangaroo. Down the center corridor. Jab two again. Uppercut. Kebabes with the knee. Ngalani's got to get out of the corner now. Kebabes running the punches. Gives back a solid right hand. Ngalani's been caught. Ngalani's been caught. Here comes Kebabes. Goes to the liver. Goes to the head. It's all scoring stuff for Tarek Kebabes.
Kebabes is throwing some serious heat right in the corner. Ngalani's got to be careful when he's dropping his head, trying to create head movement. Kebabes is throwing that knee right up the middle.
Ngalani goes to the body. Kebabes has had the higher output with the hands. He tags him again. We go to the tag. Now, once again, we've got three judges ringside. They are scoring on a 10-point must system, which means give the winner of the round 10 points, the loser of the round 9 points. If you think Ngalani won it, you give him 10 points. You give Kebabes 9. If you think it was vice versa, Kebabes gets 10, Ngalani gets 9. In my opinion, Mitch, with the flurry that Kebabes had in the corner here against Ngalani, it's a 10-9 round for Tarek Kebabes.
Ngalani looked good for those first couple minutes of that round. He was moving quite well. He was landing the kicks. But Kebabes turned it on in those last 30 seconds to steal the round away, landing some huge, thunderous shots.
Do you see anything here, Mitch? The fact that Kebabes is standing, Galani's taking a seat. He is 42 years old.
And he's stacked with muscle, like you said, the seafood platter, Michael. He is stacked, and all that muscle eats up a lot of oxygen. But we've said that about him in the past. And in his last match against Arumbold, he looked fantastic and went the distance.
The size of the chest there on Galani, it should have its own zip code. Here we go, second round of three. If there is a knockdown in the round, and the other opponent does not achieve a knockdown of his own, it'll be a 10-8 round. Kebabes coming forward strongly with the hands again. Let's see if Ngalani starts to wind with the spinning hook kicks, maybe goes to the liver, maybe goes to the jaw. Accidental groin strike there on Ngalani.
Kebabes immediately knew, threw up his hand as just a way to say, I'm sorry, apologetic. But it also gives, if there is a little bit of fatigue settling in for Ngalani, a little bit of time to catch a breather, relax a bit.
Let's take a look here and see if we can determine what exactly happened with this accidental groin strike. Kebabes comes forward, throws, okay, it was an inside thigh kick designed to hit the inside right thigh of Ngalani. It missed the target and caught Ngalani square in a place where you don't want to be caught. Apologies from Kebabes. It was not deliberate, nothing malicious in it. And there will be recovery time here. As much as 3 minutes for Alain Ngalani. How do you see Ngalani going so far in his return to kickboxing, Mitch? A four-time world champion who has plied his trade of late in the global rule set in the cage.
We've seen him primarily in mixed martial arts events, and you can see that Kebabes is not scared to strike and stand with him. Most of these guys are timid to exchange like this with Ngalani, but Kebabes is not scared at all, marching forward, throwing those heavy hands.
Dutch-style Moroccans, they are not scared of anyone. You're talking about a pedigree that includes the likes of Bada Hari. These guys come forward, and they come forward hard and nasty, as Tarek Kebabes is doing again here. We recommence in the second round. Axe kick from Ngalani. Once again, channeling his inner Kyokushin, the martial art, the hardest form of karate that he began his career in.
Trying to utilize that jab, create a little bit of space, but Kebabes is trying to corner him. He's trying to cut the angles, so he's trapping Ngalani inside the corner, but Galani's moving around very well.
This is a very large ring here at One Super Series, and both of these big men are traversing a lot of ground. How about that? The elasticized legs of Ngalani. Another attempt at axe hit. What you're trying to do with the axe is to bring the heel, the hardest bone in the body, down on the collarbone or on the nose or on the forehead of your opponent.
Ngalani's having a little more success as southpaw. He switched to a southpaw stance with his left hand back, and he's utilizing that right jab more successfully.
Kebabes, who has had to travel the longer distance to get here all the way from the Netherlands to be here tonight. Ngalani, it was only a 45 or 50 minute ferry ride from Hong Kong.
The referee has given Ngalani a warning to avoid the clinching. Go!
It's a little bit of a spillover there from Galani's MMA career. But he his natural instinct in recent years has been to move in close and clinch up with opponents. Good outside leg from Kebabes. And Ngalani off the rope for that powerful right hand.
But I also think it's his head movement. You can see Ngalani circles out to the head. He moves his head out. And then at that point, Kebabes closes the distance and they end up in the clinch. But I don't think it's purposeful. I don't think he's trying to clinch. His hands are down. It's hard to clinch with your hands down.
Kebabes looks for that bolo punch, goes for an outside leg kick, trying to tenderize the legs of the big Cameroonian. Uppercut again went higher than the ceiling. Referee breaks them.
See, it's just that head movement that he's ended up entangled.
Go.
Ngalani on the back foot, throws another accent, needs to be on the front foot a little more here, does Ngalani. Kebabes, the outside leg kick, he has taken on and beaten some very good names, Tariq Kebabes, over the years, including Roman Kriklia.
Ready? Go!
Of course, Alain Ngalani in his kickboxing days went into battle against the likes of Bob Sapp, against Carter Williams, against Michael McDonald. And here he is, two rounds deep with one remaining. He's returned to kickboxing, and there is the Kyokushin axe kick from Alain Ngalani. It is spectacular, though ineffective so far.
I'm going to put you on the spot, Michael. You gave the first round to Kebabes. How did you see the second round?
I think a much closer round, a difficult round for the judges to score. If I was going to edge it, though, Mitch, I've got to go Tariq Kebabes again, a very slight 10-9 round. I feel Ngalani is backing up a little too much for my liking. Doesn't look good to the judges scoring here ringside, and Kebabes is landing four hands. While we have seen Ngalani do the spectacular stuff, it hasn't landed for him yet. It hasn't had an effect on Tariq Kebabes. He's going to start to take his toll on Kebabes with one round remaining. 3 minutes only, Mitch.
And the spectacular techniques do score slightly higher.
So let me explain. 10-point must system. I gave the first round 10-9 Kebabes. I gave the second round 10-9 Kebabes. My scorecard goes 20-18 Kebabes, which means to even the score, Ngalani needs a 10-8 round, needs a knockdown round on Tariq Kebabes.
Now, fans at home, Michael Chiavello is not a judge. He's just pretending to be one on TV.
Outside leaking from Ngalani. Good jab to overhand right there from the Cameroonian. Kebabes looks at the power in the right. High left roundhouse kick from Ngalani. Double forearm guard blocks the kick. Oh, counter from Kebabes. Ngalani drops the head. Kebabes doesn't clinch up. Referee Onari breaks them.
I like those two question mark kicks he threw, and then he went to the body. Oh, no. Ngalani's wobble.
Ngalani momentarily turned his back. Referee, though, didn't see it as a chance to put a count on him. Kebabes comes forward. Here's the left hand from Kebabes. There's the uppercut. Goes to the body. Now toe-to-toe. They juke it out. Kebabes wins the battle. Backs him up with the right hand. Got to get out of the corner here. Ngalani takes a knee. He's lining up the right hand. There it is. And another uppercut. The chin through the top of the head. Ngalani may go down. Ngalani may go down. He's right for the picking. Ngalani on rubber legs. And he's still here. How is he still standing? The man from Hong Kong.
How is he still on his feet? He just got hit with about 13 clean shots. And he's still throwing.
Tremendous heart and intestinal fortitude from Ngalani. Takes another big right hand. And down he goes. Now it's a count on Ngalani. Three knockdowns in one round and the contest is over. That is knockdown number one in this round on Ngalani. And that is all. An absolute war.
Man, those shots, I could feel them in my bones sitting here in the commentary booth. Tariq Kebabes unloaded a fury, but Ngalani stood there like the champ that he is and took it.
took the best that Kababe's had to offer, but ultimately crumbled under the pressure.
Could it be a contender for the GoDaddy knockout of the night? Take a look at the power here, the volume and power. There was the right hand to the jaw. That's what did the damage. And then he finished off Alain Ngalani. Kababe's one Super Series debut will take the win back to the Netherlands and Morocco. Let's go to Dominic Lau to make it all official.
Ladies and gentlemen, after 1 minute and 49 seconds in the third and final round, here is your winner by way of knockout, Tariq Kababe's.
The time for talk is over. Michael Ciavello, Mitch Chilson with you. That's Mauro Cirilli of Italy. Brandon Vera, defending champion of the Philippines. Vera at 113 kilos. Cirilli at 111 kilos. More beef than a cattle ranch in the cage at the moment. High kick early from Vera. There will be Vera's speed and precision against the raw power of the Italian hammer. And look out for the overhand right on Mauro Cirilli. Vera chops downstairs. Cirilli wants to bridge the gap, get on the inside, and go for the champion's jaw.
Cirilli's trying to close that distance, having a hard time dealing with the range of Vera. But he's got to get on the inside. He can't stay at the end of these kicks.
Vera has the height. He's got the reach. Wants to keep the Italian at bay. Switches to southpaw here. Look out for the high kick off the left leg here from Vera. It's a lead hook. Oh, swinging.
Going back, chin up to protect, right on the chin.
Still one heavyweight world champion, Brendan Vera.
Sakina in the red, Machado in the camouflage gray, black and white. Sakina on the outside here. He'll look to shoot in and try and put the BJJ black belt on his back. Sakina's chin wide open though here. Fires out a punt kick there. There's the Japanese warrior. What a personality. Fan favorite is Sakina. Not always the prettiest of technique to watch, but thoroughly entertaining. Machado clubs up high. He knows the power that Shrek packs in those hands. Probing with the lead hand here. Machado goes up to the head.
Machado might want to start going to the body with those kicks. He's wide open for a nice, beautiful takedown from Sakina.
And indeed does put the BJJ black belt on his back. Goes to side control, lands a knee. How do you have this big fella on top of you?
Oh, this is Sakina's world, the seven-time Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu champion. He's got him on top, who floats over the back, secures, but look at him, his own just standing right back up. But Sakina drags him back down to the ground. Sakina moves very well on the ground.
Strength of the jersey from the 117-kilo Hideki Sakina here in the first round. Having the back of Machado. Machado crawls towards the cage. Impressive start here from Sakina.
Sakina's got to make Machado carry his weight a little bit more. He's got to get a little bit higher on the back, because that's the way, with that body lock, Sakina is able to drag Machado wherever he wants.
Just ragdolling Machado early on here, Sakina, who began training in judo as a six-year-old after being the victim of bullying at school. Fell in love with the art, continued his training all the way through college at Yamanashi Gakuin University. Still ragdolling Machado here, Mitch.
See the frustration starting to build on Alessandro Machado. He's got to break that grip. When he stands back up, he immediately has to put both hands on one of Sakina's hands and start to push.
push away because Sakina has that grip and he's able to just toss him around.
Top position now for Hideki Kasinga. Can he get inside? He is inside the half guard. Can he posture up and work those massive meat hooks? Ashado trying to work his way out of this predicament. Sakina has been a dominant force. Takes the back standing again, does the Japanese warrior.
He's got to put his back up against the cage and he's got to start fighting that grip. He's got to put both hands on one of Sakina's arms and start to separate the body lock. Sakina might just take his right leg behind and trip him back down to the ground, just like that.
JJ Blackburn under Marcos and Roberto Satoshi Souza is Sakina. Looks for another wrenching takedown on Machado.
Well, Machado was able to transition to a single leg, can't hold on to the ring like that, or the cage.
Sakina actually looking for his first win in one championship. He is 0-2 here so far. Impressive in the opening round, the big fella from Japan. Overhand left there, misses the target from Machado. Double leg to a single leg now from Sakina, gives up on that. Machado, where does he go from here, Dragon?
Machado, he's got to see how Sakina is controlling that left arm there. He's not able to swing the arm around, so he can't stand back up. Sakina's got such powerful paws. He's just holding on to the hands of Machado, and he's not able to get back up. Good job by Machado to work his way back up to his feet. Now he's got the wizard, and he's able to get the underhook on the left side. Now he's got to try to pry Sakina up. Sakina's got the body lock. He's been ragdolling Machado all night with that.
This is the fifth of sixth of our prelim card inside the magnificent Mall of Asia Arena in Manila, the Philippines. It's one championship conquest of champions. Hope you're enjoying it, folks. Live on Facebook, live on Twitter. Also, make sure you download the One Super app. It's all fights, it's all live, it's all absolutely free. 25 seconds to go in this one.
Good job.
A fantastic round for Sakina, Dragon.
Good job for Machado to try to frame a ray to create a little bit of space, but Sakina is relentless inside that clinch. But no, Machado is able to get away. He finally gets the giant off of him.
This one's going to go a lot longer than many pundits thought. It's going to get out of the first round and go into the second. Well, what a round for Hideki Sakina. Now, don't forget, under this global mixed martial arts rule set, we do score on an overall match, not round by round, as you saw in One Super Series.
Look at this. Beautiful little setup there. He's reaching out. He's going through. But then he connected on a nice little left hand on the overhand. But then look at Sakina, able to get in, get the hands wrapped around Bebezon and throws it. Beautiful outside trip there. Steps in across, puts Machado onto his back. I was asking Sakina about his cardio. You know, I was worried to see if this thing goes past 5 minutes, how is he going to handle the cardio? He says, I can grapple straight for 35 minutes with the best grapplers in the world. Do you think 5 minutes is a problem for me?
Make sure to vote on the One Super app for the bounce of the night. You could win an all-expenses-paid trip to a One Championship event. Download the One Super app now. Bout of the night. Make your vote. Second round of three of this heavyweight stash between Alessandro Machado of Brazil and Hideki Sakina of Japan. The Mall of Asia Arena, I'd say we're now at about 85%, and they are still filing in. I'm telling you, Mitch, they are going to turn away thousands at the door tonight. This is the hottest ticket in town, the biggest One Championship event. It's Conquest of Champions.
Sakina is able to keep his distance with that rear leg push kick. And his own gets inside the pocket, starts letting the hands go a little bit.
Big looping punches there from Sakina. And he's starting to gas the big fella, hands around the waist, but I'm not sure if Machado's striking can really capitalize on it. Shoots in for a single here, Sakina tries for a driving takedown to no avail on that occasion. Goes to a double leg now, does the big man. Looping right hook there from Sakina, and Shrek breaks off.
Good job by Machado to avoid that bum rush of a takedown. Utilize the underhooks, pick Sakina up, and push him off.
Machado just staying out of range of the hands of Sakina. Overhand right there. Is this when that lactic acid starts to build up and slow you down and get inside the muscles, make you make the arms heavy, the legs heavy?
If you do something you're unused, if you're not used to it. And striking, they both, oh, nice right hand there, landed by Machado. It's definitely gonna slow you down, but if this is what they're doing, if they're grappling, if they're clinching, oh, Machado, this is opening.
Sakine on his back now, here comes the ground and pound from Machado. The full mount for the Brazilian, and Sakine with a whole world above it now. Machado timing his shots. Sakine gives his back, nowhere to go. Olivier Cost says no more. Machado pounds him out in the second round.
Wow, able to get on top. He hurt him with the hands, waited for him to fall. Got on top, passed the guard, sat in mount, punched until Sakine gave up his back and landed some big shots from back mount. And Olivier Cost was forced to jump in and call a halt to it. Look at this. Big ground and pound landed. Sakine gave up the arm bar right there. Bebezon said, none of that. Put you onto your belly, and I'm going to let these hammers fly.
Alessandre Machado found the opening in the second round, found the control, and found the ferocious ground and pound. What sportsmanship there. Martial arts code, that Bushido spirit. Two fabulous warriors. Winner's medal will go around the neck and back to Brazil with Alessandre Machado. An entertaining heavyweight bout. Let's go to Tom Lau to make it all official.
Ladies and gentlemen, your referee, Mr. Olivier Cost, has called a stop to this contest after 1 minute and 44 seconds in the second round. For your winner, by way of technical knockout, Alessandre Machado!
Here we go, first round. Jab early on from Ngalani, four-time heavyweight kickboxing and Muay Thai world champion. Cirilli, Cage Warriors heavyweight champion. Six first round finishes for the Italian.
Sends Ngalani for the ride. Ngalani's gonna try to use that underhook to stand back up. He does.
Tremendous aggression early on in this bout between these two big fellas. Porky knee there from Cirilli and another one from the Italian.
I like the strategy by Cirilli to try to drain and try to wear on Ngalani, make him carry that big heavy frame of his and try to suck some of the oxygen out of them with those big gigantic muscles of Ngalani.
Ngalani, if he gets distance, will look to wind up the spinning hook kicks. You may think, how does a man of that size throw spinning hook kicks? Well, I'll tell you what, he throws them and he knocks opponents out with them. Half guard position here for Cirilli. And the hammer, drop the hammer with the ground and pound dragon.
Ngalani's got to try to take that left arm and get it underneath the right arm of Cirilli. There he goes. Now he's got underhook. Now he has to turn to his side. He can't be flattened out like that. He's got to turn onto the right side. There he goes. And he's able to get back up, but he's at knee on the way up.
Smothering tactics here from Cirilli. Big knee to the top of the head. Ngalani's got to get out of this predicament. He can't take those patellas to the skull anymore.
Cirilli's very heavy. I like how he's controlling the posture here. Ngalani, he's got to move, though. Ngalani's got to move. Maybe out.
It's over.
That might have been the top of the head, though. That was the back of the head.
Well, he's called time, but I wonder if Ngalani could go on here. If that's an illegal knee to the back of the head, Ngalani looks in a very bad way.
Yeah, he flattened out after the second knee, and I think he was hurt.
There will be recovery time here for Ngalani. He will be allowed 5 minutes, but the doctor's there taking a look at him.
What's up with you? See the first one here connects here, right there to the side of the head. I don't think that touched the ear. You have to touch the ear of your opponent if you're going to deliver strikes to the back, to the head.
I know. What do you want me to do? That was easy.
He has up to 5 minutes now to recover from this, but if he's not able to continue, the match will be ruled a no contest because we have not reached the halfway point of the round.
Is it a no contest if it's ruled an illegal strike?
If it was...
If it's a legal strike, it's going to be a knockout.
I don't think it was legal. Doc Warren is right now inside the ring, or the cage rather, and I think they're gonna bring out the stretcher. But an athlete is allowed up to 5 minutes for medical examination recovery. If an athlete is unable to resume in the allotted time, an official decision will be given.
Let's have a look at this closely again, Mitch. Let's see where the knee is.
You can see the first, you can see Ngalani actually turns his head a little bit and actually gets him right on the top of the head. You know, you're not allowed to strike the mohawk if you were to, like, you know, wear a mohawk. Michael, remember those mohawks?
I get it, Mr. T.
I had one. You're not allowed to make contact to that area of the head, and it looked like that knee landed flush on the crown of the head.
Big win for Mauro Cirilli.
4 ounce gloves on these two behemoths. And the right hand alley from Andre the Giant.
Stop,
the trigger early. Goes for the jaw of silver.
Right after the hand touch, he wasted no time rushing Braddock. Now we got to see Braddock understand what's going on. Now he's been trying to get nice and patient. Now he starts to counter punch. Watch the left hand, watch the hook to overhand right.
Junior knows he can't allow Silva to establish his rhythm. He can't allow the big Brazilian to set the metronome. Trying to give Silva a taste of the right hand early with those 4 ounce gloves. On by the Giant and overhand right. Silva knees on the inside. The Giant goes to the body, barrels him against the fence. Ties up Silva and referee Deluxus breaks them. What a crackerjack start to this one.
Munir's got to be careful. He kind of opens up a little bit when he throws those punches. Braddock might be able to catch him coming in.
High knee there from Anderson Silva. Munir's got to be careful not to drop the head. Already he's cut from the knee of Anderson Silva. Silva goes to the liver. Overhand right from Silva. Uppercut there from Munir. One look out.
Silva does what he does, counter shot with that left hook. That's all she wrote, first round KO.
And that's why Anderson Braddock Silva is one of the greatest on the planet. A one Super Series debut, he knocks out the Giant, Andre Munir.
Wow, huge knockout. Welcome to ONE Championship, Anderson Braddock Silva. You can see it, Munir knew exactly what he wanted to do. He wanted to come in serious, put the pressure on Braddock. He opened up, he threw that big shot. Silva countered, boom, put him to sleep. Big left hook, I think it was a left hook that happened so fast. That was a beautiful knockout. We knew somebody was going to sleep in the first with that one, the way these guys were throwing.
Overhand right there from Anderson Silva. Uppercut from the Giants, Andre Munir. Two huge men in 4 ounce gloves. It's the overhand right on the temple. It hits the button and turns the lights out on the Giant.
Yeah, look, he was just leaving himself a little too open, overextended. He throws that big left hook, gets whiffed, and then just overhand right, touches him on the head, doing what he does best in that beautiful combination. It's all about that left hook, right overhand, and there was the overhand. It was like a clubbing blow. Didn't even catch him full. That's the power of Anderson Braddock Silva. Wow.
Let's go to Tom Lau, make it all official.
Ladies and gentlemen, your referee, Mr. Ilias Dolatsis, has called a stop to this contest after 1 minute and 14 seconds in the first round for your winner by way of knockout, Anderson